for the fishery to be sustainable, one would like to know the life cycle, the complete life cycle. And there's really still more unknown about the Mossenai or toothfish life cycle than is known.
We don't know where the juvenile toothfish are. We don't know what they're feeding on.
We're not really sure of how often these fish breed.
Nobody's found a larval toothfish that I know of.
We don't know for sure where it spawns.
The life cycle is hypothetical.
You take all the science together and it still comes out the same. There's only one answer. We haven't got enough data.
The lead scientist advising the New Zealand government on Antarctic toothfish is Stuart Hanchett.
I'd say that it probably is premature to go into there, but I think at the same time you'd probably make the same argument for every fishery in the world. We have very, very little understanding, really. And I think the move over the last 5 to 10 years has been trying to develop the modelling and also the baseline data on which to be able to base some management decisions.
I would describe it more of an art form rather than a science. You're actually looking at it, making big assumptions and hoping you're right.
The fishermen own the ocean. They fish first and ask questions later. And we've got another example of that in the Ross Sea. Yeah.
Despite all these uncertainties, Kamlar decides to reduce the adult toothfish stock by 50% over the next 35 years.
50% is huge. If you eliminated 50% of the humans on the planet, that would have a huge impact. So if you're going to eliminate 50% of the fish, you're going to have a huge impact.
It just seems way too much, way too early.
We saw big fish, profitable, they long-lived, so they are exploited the way you would exploit a seam of coal.
Why else would anybody want to go to Antarctic waters, to the Ross Sea, if they already had plenty of fish around their home turf? There'd be no incentive. But the fact that we've lost so much everywhere else, the fishing fleets are going further and further, finally to the last wild place, the last ocean.
Just how much we've lost from our oceans is now well recorded. A map has been created from a worldwide study where leading scientists measured human impact on the world's oceans.
We began what turned into a 4-year process of pulling together data on all of the different marine ecosystems on the planet and as many of the human uses of the oceans and human impacts on the oceans that we could find. Once we produced our maps, we were able to look for those areas that are least impacted or most pristine. And we found the Ross Sea was the most pristine area of anywhere on the planet.